Hi, class. I hope you guys are having a good week. You should be right in the middle of the module on informative speaking. And what I'd like to do today is I'd like to go over the informative outline in detail. So in a few seconds, I'm going to pull up an actual sample outline for the informative speech. And then I'm just going to walk you through that outline so you can see how the outline comes together. You're going to find that the outline that we're going to use for the informative speech, very similar to the outline format we learned for the critic speech. We're just going to add some more components. And then the big thing that we're adding to the informative speech that we didn't utilize in the critic speech, we're going to be adding sources of evidence to the outline. And that's a little trickier to do when you're giving a presentation, because it's not like we end our speech and think, oh, here are my works cited, and then we go to a bibliography. That wouldn't be a very good way to have an impact on the audience if you're always ending by telling the audience where you've got the information. So what we do in public speaking, we incorporate the sources into the flow of the actual speech. So we're citing our sources as we get to the specific information in the speech. And I'm going to show you how to plug that in to your outline. So really, when you look at the outline for the informative speech, we're just going to add a few more components. There'll be an extra component in the introduction. We're going to add a third main point to the body of the speech. And then we're going to add our source citations into the speech. And for the informative speech, I'd like you to have a minimum of 4 source citations in the speech. And I'll show you exactly where those go as we take a look at the outline. Also, too, on Friday, you will be submitting your topic proposals for your informative speech. And if you didn't get a chance to check out last week's Zoom recording, might want to take a look at that. I go into some detail as far as here are some guidelines to follow in order to select an effective topic so you'll be able to have a really good experience with your informative speech. It really comes down to the topic. So better the topic, probably the better the speech is going to be. All right, so now let's go ahead and take a look at a sample outline for the informative speech, and then I'm going to walk you through that. All right, so now we have the sample outline for the informative speech, and this is the same one that you have in your module. And so what I'd like to do now is just to kind of go through that outline and just kind of point out where all the sections go. So if you first take a look at the introduction, you'll notice that with the introduction, we've got our attention getter, we're going to present the topic. We're adding a new component right here. This is establishing the significance of our topic to the audience. And kind of the deal here is, anytime you're speaking for longer than 5 minutes, I think it's always a good idea in the introduction to give the audience a couple reasons why it's in their interest to listen to you yak for the next 5 minutes or so. So this is the new component that we're adding to the introduction to the informative speech. And so we start off with our attention getter. We have the attention of the audience. By the way, this speech is going to be on instant replay review in sports. So we've got a little attention getter there about being Tom Brady. Then we get to our topic, and notice how simple the topic is. This brings me to the topic of my speech replay review. You want that topic sentence to be short, concise, so there's no doubt, any confusion about the focus of your speech. Now, in the critic speech, we went from presenting the topic right down to the thesis statement, but because we're going to be speaking a little bit longer in this speech, we're going to add this establishing of the significance to the audience. And we're going to do that right after the topic sentence. And essentially what you're doing here is you just want 2 to 3 sentences that tell the audience why this is an important, relevant topic. And with informative speaking, even though we're not doing any persuasion, we're kind of doing a little bit of persuasion right here in the significance. We're actually trying to persuade the audience, hey, listen up, this information is relevant and significant to you. And so typically, in order to do that, I tell students, hey, give your reason why you think it's an important, relevant, significant topic to the audience. But then, second, this is where your first source of evidence goes in the significance. It should be, let's say if you have 2 of your own reasons and then your source is the third, you always want that to be the last point. So it's either the second point or the third point in the significance. But here, you want to use an objective source who's also telling the audience, A, this topic, it's relevant, it's significant. So here in the establishing of the significance of instant replays, a couple reasons why we think it's important. And then lastly, we have our source. And notice, when you're citing a source in a speech, you're just telling us three things. You're going to give us the title of the publication. That's right here. That's ESPN Magazine, right? It's not the name of the article. We just want the title of the publication. And the reason why is, oftentimes when you're doing a speech like this, the less you rely on notes, the better. And so it just makes it easier for you to remember the source citation instead of, according to Chris Haney in his article, Why Instant Replay Has Been Effective for the Last Decade. It's just easier to say, according to Chris Haney in ESPN Magazine. That's easier to remember. And if I have the name of the author, the name of the publication, I can easily find the article. And then the last thing we want to include is the actual date. So remember, when you're citing a source, title of the publication, author, and the date. And there's no set order. You can kind of mix it up. Here we go, author, title of publication, and then the date. That's up to you. And so we're using that to show that replay reviews have had almost 100% efficiency rate of improving the efficiency during a game. So instant replay, pretty important. We're making sure that the calls are correct. Then we go from the significance right to the thesis statement, and your thesis statement should be really easy. In a thesis statement and what we call an academic speech, so both the informative speech and then the persuasive speech that you're going to do in a couple weeks down the road in the semester, those are both what we call academic speeches, and that just means that these are speeches that we're going to also incorporate evidence, right? So this really means it's an academic or it's a research speech. We're not just relying on our opinion, but we're relying on evidence as well. So whether you're doing an informative or persuasive speech, your thesis statement will always do two things. One, indicate your purpose for speaking. And if you're doing an informative speech, well, your purpose is to inform. So a thesis statement for an academic speech, state your purpose. It'll either be to inform or later to persuade, and then you just restate your topic. So here, the purpose of my speech is to inform you about the impact of replay review. And you can kind of, you know, change the words a little bit. The purpose of my speech is to create a deeper understanding on the impact of replay review. So anything that kind of suggests my purpose here is to inform, to give you information, to increase your understanding, to enhance your comprehension, anything like that will work for your thesis. But remember, short, simple, concise statement, my purpose as a speaker, and I restate the title of the speech. And then the last thing we're going to do is we're going to end our introduction by previewing the three main points that we'll cover in the body of the speech. So that's another thing that is new when we look at the body of the informative speech. We'll have three main points instead of two, and you get to pick the three main points. Now, when you submit your topic proposals, not only will you indicate your topic, but I also want you to indicate what you are considering your three main points to be in the body of the speech. And that just helps me. Again, one of the hardest things I think for students to do in a beginning public speaking class is to come to a really good understanding of the difference between an informative speech and a persuasive speech. And then that can be hard because some speeches can go either way. In fact, this speech right here, replay review, this speech could also be done as what we would call an attitudinal persuasive speech. That's a speech that focuses on what can be considered an issue of controversy. And there's lots of controversy surrounding replay review. So I could turn this into a persuasive speech where I'm here to convince you that we need to get rid of instant replay, or I'm here to support the use of instant replay. But that's not my purpose here. I just want to get you better educated. And so when you have a topic that could be seen as controversial, notice in the body of the speech, and I mentioned this last week in the Zoom meeting, that I just focus on the benefits and the drawbacks. I'm looking at the advantages or the disadvantages. That means I'm covering both sides. I'm not taking a stand on one or the other. That's what keeps this topic in the realm of being an informative speech. So when you turn in your topic proposals for the informative speech, when you indicate what your three main points are going to be, that just gives me more information I can use to determine whether you're going to keep this as an informative speech. If I see something that alludes to trying to support one stand on the issue or the other, or if it looks like a problem to be solved, then I will probably tell you, let's get a better topic that will work as an informative. These topics seem to work better as a persuasive speech. So make sure when you submit your topic proposals, I get those three main points. That just helps me make a better determination of whether or not you have a good topic and you're headed in the right direction as far as doing it as an informative speech. So just by way of review, if you look at the introduction, we've got our attention getter, we've got our topic sentence, then we go to establishing significance, our thesis statement, and then we're going to end the introduction by telling the audience the titles of our main points in the same order we will cover them when we get to the body of the speech. So make sure you put your titles in here. And then something too you can add, like notice in the outline, I go preview, history of replays, how replay reviews are used today, benefits and drawbacks. I'm not actually writing out how I'm going to present that info. I'm just going to do that when I actually deliver the speech. But if you want a nice little easy way to kind of elevate your speech and make it sound more academic, I always tell students, always use a verb package in your preview. And what I mean by that is have a specific verb you're going to use to introduce main point one, main point two, and main point three. For example, back when I was doing public speaking competitively, I would always use in my preview, first we'll consider, then we'll explore, and then finally, we'll examine. So consider, explore, examine. I would use that as my verb package. It just makes the preview stand out a little bit more. Instead of, in the next few minutes, I'm gonna look at the history of replays. I'm gonna look at how replay reviews are used today. I'm gonna look at the benefits and the drawbacks. Spruce up the language. Words are your toolbox as a speaker. And so let's get out of that little recipe box. Let's get some big toolboxes. You want that kind you get when you go into Sears, right? You roll that thing around, you got all kinds of words you can use. You want to make sure that word selection is an important part of being an effective public speaker. That being said, though, you never want to sound like you're using words just to sound smart. You want to use words to keep the audience into the presentation. So you also want to make sure that you're using words that relate to the audience. All right, let's move on to the body of the speech. And that's pretty simple. So whatever we're doing as our topic for our informative speech, we're going to divide that into three sections. Those will be our three main points. And, you know, if you watch the video that was done by Ms. Patero, another one of our speakers, another one of our communication studies professors at Solano, as she was kind of going through that, she gave you different ways to maybe organize the body. For an informative speech, past, present, future, that chronological order works really well, especially if you're talking about any kind of invention or anything that's been created. And we're kind of using that here when we look at our first main point, history of replays. So we're going to go into the background. Second main point, we're going to examine how replays are being used today. And instead of going to replays in the future, hear what the speaker did, because you can kind of look at replay review as maybe being controversial, as I said at the start. So just to really cement the topic in informative land, rather than going to the future, we're looking at the benefits and the drawbacks, the advantages and the disadvantages. The three main points that you come up with are completely up to you. That chronological order works well, past, present, future. Also, the topical format works really well. Also, where you're just picking the three most important subtopics for a particular topic. All right, and then just to kind of go through each of the main points. Also too, notice in this outline how everything is spread out. And that's one thing I mentioned for some of you with your critic speech, because really when you create the outline, you're doing two things. One, it's the best way to prepare a speech, and the outline is a good tool to use if you're going to use notes to deliver the presentation. It's much better than writing things out in essay form, because when it's in an outline, it's easier to glance down and find your place. So here, we want to make sure that everything is spread out. I try to really encourage students, when you're doing an outline, follow the rule, one sentence per subpoint, right? You don't want to jam a big paragraph in here, because if you're using your outline to deliver the speech, you want to be able to glance down, easily find that next line, pop your head up, and continue in the speech. So that's why that spacing is so important. And then I even would argue this is the best way to create an outline, even if you're not going to use the outline to deliver the speech. You're just going to use the outline to practice and learn the speech. When you spread everything out, every line stands out. So I believe that you're going to retain the information more easily if you can more easily see each of the lines, as opposed to I've got five lines bunched in a paragraph. Every time I practice that paragraph, I'm more likely to lose my focus on a particular line or two because it's just bunched up. Here, everything stands out. I always kind of liken that to having kids, right? You want to make sure that you can see everyone. Everyone stands out. Everyone gets their own number so they feel special. So spread your content out. It's a good way to learn your speech, even if you're practicing the speech, so you ultimately give that speech without the use of notes. And it's also the best way to put your notes together if you're going to deliver a speech using the overall outline. So follow that rule, one sentence per subpoint. And also remember this, repetition is the key to retention. And so if you ever want to give a speech without the use of notes, put your outline together and then start 1 week before the actual presentation of the speech. If you just take your outline and read it out loud 3 times a day, every day for 7 days leading up to that presentation, you will overlearn the information. What I mean by that is the more you say the speech over and over and over again, the more easily you're going to retain that information. So I'm not real big on memorization. Like, I'm going to sit down, I'm going to really focus on memorizing each of the lines. I'm just going to repeat, 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 repeat until I retain the information well enough I can get through it without the use of notes. For those of you that are athletes, that's basically what you do in practice, right? You're getting in the repetition, so when you get in the game, you can just react naturally. We're using that same concept here. Repetition is the key to retention. And I also learned that by just watching you kids when we were back on campus, bumping around campus. You got your headset on and you're just bumping your gums. You know the song to every rap tune. And it's not like you go, oh, I really like this song by Kendrick Lamar, I'm going to commit that to memory. No, it's just that constant repetition, 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 repetition. That's how you retain information. Let's remember that and apply that to public speaking as well. All right, a couple other things I want to draw your attention to. As you look at each of the main points, notice that in each main point, you want to have at least one source citation. So overall for the assignment, we want 4 source citations. That first one will be in your last point in the significance, in the introduction, and then you just want to make sure that you have at least one source citation in each of your 3 main points, and I've highlighted those in orange. And again, you're telling us the title of the publication, the author, and the date. And when you work your source citations into a speech, I think it's wise that you always cite the source before you give the information from the source. It's kind of like establishing the credibility of the information before you present the information. And then the other thing that I like as well It just seems to flow better if you get the source first, then you end with the information rather than giving the information and then, oh, by the way, here's the source citation. So when you're citing your sources, title of the publication, author, and the date, and you want to work those what I call according to's in at the start of a subpoint, not at the end of a subpoint. And then I just want to make sure at the end of my first main point, I have a transition. My transition should do two things. It should tell me the point that I'm leaving and the point that I'm going into. So here, the first replay, while seemingly minor, unlocked the door to our next point of consideration, replay reviews today. And I know that seems so simple, but if you leave out the transition, your audience won't know when you go from one point to the next. I mean, if you just look at this speech, we would go, CBS had opened Pandora's box. Then we would jump all the way down to today. Almost every professional sport utilizes the replay process, but the audience isn't going to be clear. We're going from one point to the next. That's why we have transitions. Transitions are the glue that hold the body of the speech together. Then we go into our second main point. We're going to focus on the present, replays today. We've got another source citation here. And this is an example of a website. And so anytime that you're citing a website, always give us the name of the website, not the address. The addresses are way too long, harder for you to remember, harder for the audience to remember. So you just tell us the title of the website. Now, with a lot of websites, it's a little bit harder to find an author. And so typically, as a rule, I won't use a source from a website unless I know who said it. The only exception, if I'm looking at a website and it's clear that that website should be an authority on the subject, like here I'm talking about instant replay in the NFL, and so to me, NFL.com would be a reputable source, so here I can probably get away without an actual name. Also, I don't have a date that that article was published, and so what I would use is the date that I last accessed the information. And so this student, when they were doing their speech, this is from a couple of years ago, that was the date they got the information. So another way you can do it is, it's a little better if you can go last updated. That means it's been done by the website. But if you're getting information from a website, I think the best way to go is, if I don't have a name, if I don't have a date, I'm not going to use that source unless I'm pretty confident that when the audience hears the title of the website, they'll accept that information as being credible. Like maybe I'm doing a speech on astronauts and I cite something from NASA without an author. I think that would be an example of something that I could use that would have credibility. But you've got to be careful with internet sources. They've made it so much more difficult in terms of coming up with good supportive information. It's too easy to kind of fudge and just get stuff from random websites. We don't know where the information came from. So good rule to follow, even for websites, have an author, have a date. All right, and then at the end of our second main point, we're going to have a transition. Again, we're going to refer to the title of the main point we're leaving, the title of the main point we're going into, with this understanding of the role of replay reviews today. Let's consider the benefits and drawbacks. Now the audience knows that I'm going into my last point. In my last point, I've got my source citation here from ESPN.com. And when I get to the end of the third main point, I do not need a transition. So you don't need a transition at the end of your last main point, because you go from that last line in main point three right into your summary of your three main points. So if you had a transition, then your summary, it would just be redundant. So no transition at the end of your third main point. And then in the conclusion, pretty similar to what you did with the critic speech, you're going to summarize your three main points. So in the last few minutes, we covered this, we examined this, we explored this, then I'm going to restate my thesis, and then finally, I want to end my speech in a way that has a nice sense of impact on the audience and also has a nice sense of finality. A few of you, in your critic speeches, you kind of rush that last line. You want to make sure that you really slow things down, especially on that last phrase, so that you can just use your voice to create a sense of finality. So instead of, and if your team loses, it's because, well, they suck. And that's kind of fast. And if your team loses, it's because, well, they suck. See how that has a little bit more of a sense of finality. I'm going to drop my vocal tone on that last syllable because it's uncomfortable if you're giving a presentation and you say that last line, you know your speech is over, but the audience isn't, wait, is that the last line? And they're like, wait, do I clap kind of thing? So you always want to make sure that last line, strong sense of impact, even more importantly, it's got a strong sense of finality so the audience knows that you're done. And always end your speech with the last line in the speech. You don't need to say that last line and then go, thank you, right? In fact, I don't understand why speakers would thank an audience at the end of the speech. You're doing all the work, right? They thank you with the round of applause. So last line, nothing after it. Take a second to take in the imaginary applause since we're doing this remotely, and then your speech is done. All right, so hopefully that gives you a really good understanding of the outline format that you're going to follow. What I'm going to do a little bit later today, I'm going to post an announcement on our Canvas page, and I'm going to add a couple more sample outline. I want to get a sample outline in there of an informative speech that's done on a person. In case you wanted to do your speech on a person, you've got an outline for that. And then I'm going to see if I have an informative outline on some kind of technology, something like that. So you have two more examples to go along with this one. And you just want your outline to look exactly like the sample outline. Last thing, too, I really don't care that much about the formatting as far as, you know, Roman numerals, letters, numbers, however you want to do it, whatever makes it easier for you, cool. But I do want you to make sure that you identify each of the sections. I want to know that you know what your topic sentence is. If you just put your whole intro in a paragraph, that doesn't tell me you know the difference between your attention getter, your topic sentence, the significance. So make sure that you have all of the headings into the outline. All right? Okay, that's more than enough today. You guys have a good week. Let's come up with some really good, cool, informative topics. And I like informative speeches because I always learn something as a result of listening to you. All right, we'll see you guys later.